In this lesson, we will explore another type of estate called a leasehold estate. As the name implies, a leasehold estate is created through a lease for real property, real estate. A leasehold estate refers to a tenant's exclusive but temporary right to possess, occupy, and use real estate, land, or property during the term of a lease. Rather than being considered an interest in real property itself, a leasehold estate is considered to be a personal property interest. There are four primary types of leasehold estates. We will examine each of these in more detail later in this lesson. Before doing that, however, let's explore some common terms that apply to all kinds of leasehold estates. First, you will need to become familiar with the lessor-lessee terminology. The lessor is the landlord, the person who is actually allowing someone else to possess, occupy, and use his or her real property. The lessee is the tenant who contracts with the lessor for the right to possess, occupy, and use the real estate. George is new to town and is looking for somewhere to live. Carla is a homeowner who just accepted a 10-month position teaching English in Germany. If George decides to enter into a lease with Carla to live in her home while she is out of the country for that 10-month period, Carla is the lessor and George is the lessee. Now, let's dive into the four types of leasehold estates. The most common type is known as an estate for years. An estate for years is an interest in land that arises by contract for possession for a definite but limited period of time. Although the word years is in the name, an estate for years can actually be for any period of time, even if it is shorter than 1 year. Typically, an estate for years lasts at least 1 year. At the end of the predetermined time period, the lessee, the tenant, must vacate the property. In some cases, the tenant may be able to surrender their lease, which means voluntarily giving up their rights to occupy, possess, and use the land before the end of the lease. Under an estate for years, rent may be paid monthly, quarterly, annually, or in any other kind of installments spelled out in the lease. Sometimes the terms fixed-term tenancy or tenancy for years are used interchangeably with estate for years. Let's go back to George and Carla in our example. If the lease they sign says that George can possess, occupy, and use the real estate for 10 months, this is an estate for years. If, after 6 months, George no longer wants to continue with the lease, he can surrender it and move out. However, the lease may provide Carla with legal remedies in this case. The next type of leasehold estate is known as a periodic estate. Remember that under an estate for years, the lease spells out a specific time period at which point the lease will terminate. A periodic estate is different. With a periodic estate, there is a rental period defined by the lease, but there is not a predetermined lease termination date. The rental period might be a week, month, or a year. The amount of rent is fixed for that rental period. This type of leasehold estate is also known as an estate from period to period or a periodic tenancy. If you have heard of or been a party to a month-to-month lease, that is a great example of a periodic estate. If the landlord and the tenant have not expressly included another type of arrangement in the lease, many states say that the lease is automatically a periodic estate. under a periodic estate, if the landlord wants to end the lease, they must give notice to vacate. Similarly, if a tenant wants to end the lease, he or she must also provide notice as specified in the lease. It's also important to note that, in most cases, an estate for years will automatically become a periodic estate when the first lease ends. Let's take a look at an example of a periodic estate that might help you understand it better. Jack and Chrissy want to rent an apartment while their new house is being built. Ralph has an open unit in a building he owns, so he offers them a month-to-month lease with an initial rent amount of $1,200. Jack and Chrissy decide to sign the lease and they move in on July 1st. They pay $1,200 in rent for July, and on August 1st, they pay $1,200 in rent for August. That same day, Ralph informs them that the rent is going up effective September 1st. If they want to continue living there, the rent will be $1,250 a month. Ralph has the right to raise the rent in this manner because the lease term is month to month. Jack and Chrissy would have the right to terminate the lease with notice to Ralph. If Ralph found someone else willing to rent the space for a longer period of time, he may decide to terminate the periodic estate with notice to Jack and Chrissy. The next type of leasehold estate we will look at is known as an estate at will. Under an estate at will, the occupation of the land or apartment unit is for an undefined period of time and can be terminated by either the landlord or the tenant or both of them. There are a few different ways a tenancy at will can come about. The landlord and the tenant agree that there does not need to be a formal lease. The landlord and the tenant agree that no rent or other consideration needs to be paid for the tenant to occupy, possess, and use the landlord's real estate. The tenant has an urgent need or desire to occupy the property, but there hasn't been time to formalize the terms in a lease yet. When the lease is finally inked, in this case, the estate at will is going to terminate. A tenancy at will can even be created when a family member is allowed to stay at home without any kind of formal written agreement, although this may require them to pay some sort of nominal amount of rent or other consideration for the arrangement. The language of an at-will lease or oral agreement can be very important. If an estate at-will specifies that the lease continues at the will or desire of the tenant, the landlord may not be able to terminate the lease, even for cause. An estate at-will can generally be terminated in the following ways. The landlord transfers the property to someone else. The landlord dies. The tenant dies. The tenant tries to assign his or her tenancy, for example, by trying to sublet the space to someone else. The tenant causes some change or damage to the property, whether intentional, voluntary, or not, without the permission or direction of the landlord. This is also sometimes referred to as committing waste against the property. Because of its informal nature, an estate at will can be risky for both the landlord and the tenant. Here's an example of an estate at will. Helen owns her home and a condo which is vacant. Her adult son, Bill, has fallen on hard times, so Helen decides to let Bill move into the condo. Because she knows that money is tight for Bill right now, She says he does not need to pay her any rent while he gets back on his feet. Neither of them thinks about writing any kind of formal lease agreement for the arrangement. Helen has created an estate at will with Bill. Unfortunately, their relationship sours over the course of the next couple of months. Helen decides she does want to start receiving rent for the condo. Bill stubbornly refuses to pay rent and says he's going to keep living there. Helen will likely need to go to court to start eviction proceedings in order to get Bill removed from the condo. Finally, the last of the four types of leasehold estates is known as an estate at sufferance. Sometimes this is also referred to as a tenancy at sufferance or a holdover tenancy. An estate at sufferance arises when there was a lease in place, but the tenant did not renew the lease and did not move out when the lease expired. Instead, he or she continued occupying the space and continued paying the same rent as before. Under an estate at sufferance, the landlord has a couple of choices. They could decide to treat the tenant as a trespasser and go to court to have the tenant evicted. However, another option is to simply accept the tenant for another similar term, i.e., another month or another year, under the same conditions as specified under the original lease. If the landlord had told the tenant that the rent was going up before the original lease expired, the landlord can charge the higher rent for the holdover tenant. For an example of a holdover tenancy, let's go back to the original example we used earlier in this lesson. George is looking for somewhere to live, and Carla needs a tenant while she is out of the country for the school year teaching. Let's say that George and Carla signed a one-year lease. Carla has accepted an offer to stay on as a teacher in Europe for one more year. So, at the 10-month point in the lease, she notifies George that he can renew the lease for another one-year period, but at a rent amount that is 5% higher than what he has been paying. George never responds to Carla. The original lease ends at the one-year mark. If George continues living in Carla's house, he is a holdover tenant, and an estate at sufferance has been created. Carla can charge him the new, higher monthly rental amount. However, she could also choose to take George to court to have him evicted, since there is no lease in place giving him the right to continue possessing, occupying, or using her property.